Introduction to Raggedy Ann's Wishing Pebble. Love of Pleasant Hill, California. Raggedy Ann's Wishing Pebble by Johnny Gruelle. Introduction to Wishing Pebble. Raggedy Ann and Raggedy Andy were two little rag dolls. Very quiet little creatures stuffed with nice white cotton. They had bright shoe button eyes and cheery, happy smiles painted upon their rag faces. Raggedy Ann and Raggedy Andy were very happy little creatures too, for they were over 50 years old and had always had so much fun in their raggedy lives, they just couldn't help being joyous and kindly. Raggedy Andy always said, "The reason Raggedy Ann is so lovable and kindly and generous and able to think so nicely is because she has a candy heart with the words, 'I love you,' printed on it." But Raggedy Andy was just as kindly and cheery and generous as dear Raggedy Ann, and he has no candy heart. And maybe it is just as Raggedy Ann has often said to the other dolls in the nursery, if one just thinks nice, kindly things, if one just does generous, helpful deeds, then that person is filled with a thrill of happiness which shines right through even the shabbiest clothes and brings loving friends close by. One evening, all the dolls in the nursery, Raggedy Ann, Raggedy Andy, Henny, the Dutch doll, Frederica, Uncle Clem, a very nice man doll with yarn mustache and a policeman's uniform, and the French doll and all the others sat around telling stories. When it came to Raggedy Ann's turn, she told of the adventures she and Raggedy Andy had with the camel with the wrinkled knees. It was very exciting and so interesting, none of the dolls closed their eyes even a smidgen while Raggedy Ann spoke in her soft, cottony rag voice. Then, when Raggedy Ann had finished, she told all the dolls it was time they were in bed. And indeed it was, for it was almost time for smiling Mr. Sun to come peeping into the windows. So all the dolls hurried and jumped into bed in just the same positions their little mistress, Marcella, had placed them early in the evening. In a few minutes, everything was so still you could have heard the patter of a teeny-weeny mouse if he had trip-tripped across the floor. Then Raggedy Andy raised up on his cotton-stuffed elbow and whispered to Raggedy Ann, "Let's have another adventure, shall we?" And Raggedy Ann's shoe-button eyes wiggled with pleasure, and she whispered in reply, "Yes, Raggedy Andy, let's do." So they tiptoed quietly to the window, climbed to the sill, and catching hands, jumped to the ground below. Blump, blump. And so this adventure began. Let us start a garden, you and I. Let us turn the soil of acquaintanceship, and in this fertile ground plant kindly thoughts. Let us pull all the weeds of envy and selfishness and destroy them. Let us water our garden with the dew of sympathy. Let us keep our growing plants in the sunshine of love, and happiness is ours. Our garden is filled with the beautiful flowers of friendship. The Adventures of Raggedy Ann and Raggedy Andy. Raggedy Ann and Raggedy Andy went skipping over the yellow meadow, each with a rag arm around the other's neck. When the two Raggedys reached a clump of goldenrod, they heard tiny voices laughing and singing. "Shh," both Raggedys whispered to each other as they crept up closer. "You need not be so quiet," a teeny-weeny silvery voice called to them from the goldenrod. "We can see you easily and knew you were coming." Raggedy Ann and Raggedy Andy laughed happily as they pushed aside the goldenrod and saw hundreds of cunning little brownies. "We did not know who it might be," said Raggedy Ann, "and we did not wish to frighten you away until we saw who you were." "And then did you wish to frighten us away?" one of the tiny brownies asked. Raggedy Ann and Raggedy Andy laughed as cheerily as all the brownies at this. "No, indeed," Raggedy Ann said when they had stopped laughing. "We did not wish to have you quit your happy games, that's what I meant to say, so we were just tiptoeing up easily, and then we would have gone away." "Well, we are glad you came," one of the little brownie men said, "for you can join in our fun." "Thank you," the two raggedies cried. "We like fun. What are you playing?"
"We were just planning to fly down to the Looking Glass Brook and slide on the water, so you may go with us."
"We would like to go," Raggedy Andy answered, "but we cannot fly, nor can we slide upon the surface of the water without getting wet. But then, that's fun too, because our rag bodies are stuffed with nice white cotton, and we soon dry out in the lovely warm sunshine."
The little brownies laughed, and one said, "When you slide with us, you won't get even a little teeny-weeny speck wet." And waving his hands to the other brownies, he caught Raggedy Andy's hand. Other little brownies caught Raggedy Andy's feet and Raggedy Ann's hands and feet and whisked them up over the goldenrod and out across the yellow meadow to the Looking Glass Brook. When the little brownies and the two raggedies reached the Looking Glass Brook, they all ran as hard as they could and went sliding across the smooth surface of the water. It was just like sliding upon ice, except when one of the brownies or one of the raggedies fell down, they bounced up again, for the surface of the Looking Glass Brook gave beneath them like rubber ice, and they did not get their heads bumped. As they slid along upon the top of the water, Raggedy Ann and Raggedy Andy could see the pretty little fish swimming about and chasing each other back and forth, just as if they were having games too. The raggedies and the little brownies were not the only ones who were sliding upon the surface of the water, for while they were resting, they saw queer little tiny long-legged creatures come sliding along. And one came right up to the brownies and Raggedy Ann and Andy.
"Why, he has a tiny boat on each of his feet," Andy cried in surprise.
"Oh, yes," a little brownie said. "He's one of the little ferrymen."
"Do you mean that he carries tiny passengers across the Looking Glass Brook?" asked Raggedy Ann.
"That is just what they do," laughed the little brownies. "You see, many little creatures cannot walk upon the water, and if they happen to fall into the water and try to swim across, the little fish sometimes most always eat them up. So the little ferrymen, or water boatmen, as they are sometimes called, run from one point upon the Looking Glass Brook to the other point, and they carry passengers, for the fish never disturb the ferrymen."
"And I suppose the tiny creatures pay the little ferrymen with seeds or something like that?" said Raggedy Andy.
"Oh no," laughed the little brownies. "The little ferrymen never ask pay for carrying the tiny creatures across, because, you see, they get so much fun out of sliding across the Looking Glass Brook themselves, so that it is all the pay they wish." When the little brownies told the raggedies that it was time they went to work, each little brownie gave the rag dolls a kiss. Each kiss left a tiny brown freckle on each of the raggedies' faces, just like the little faces of boys and girls who have been kissed by the brownies. Then, with a lot of tiny brownie whoops, The cunning creatures flew high in the air and across the meadow, leaving the two Raggedies watching the little kindly water boatman carrying the tiny bug passengers across the looking glass brook. And the Raggedies, with an arm about each other's neck, felt that their little cotton-stuffed heads were filled with happiness, for you know how much pleasure it gives you when you see someone doing unselfish deeds and kindly acts for those in need, and even if it is only a very, very tiny little deed of kindness. The Raggedies knew that however small they may be, the kindly deeds grow and grow until they blossom and fill our hearts with the sunshine of happiness. End of chapter 1. Chapter 2 of Raggedy Ann's Wishing Pebble, Love of Pleasant Hill, California. Raggedy Ann's Wishing Pebble by Johnny Gruelle, Chapter 2. As the Raggedies sat upon the bank of the Looking Glass Brook and watched the little water boatman carry the tiny creatures across, a ripple came circling by them, then another and another, until the little water boatman rocked as they slid over the tops of the ripples. "It looks just as if the Looking Glass Brook was smiling," laughed Raggedy Ann. Then, as the ripples came faster and faster and closer together, the two Raggedies peeked over the edge of the bending grasses and saw a queer little dumpy creature standing in the water and digging a hole in the bank. He wore a little round felt hat and worked in his shirt sleeves. The Raggedies could not see the little dumpy creature's face until they spoke to him and he looked up at them. Then they saw it was Mr. Muskrat, and his bright little eyes danced laughingly behind round spectacles. "Whatever are you doing, Mr. Muskrat?" Raggedy Ann asked. "You are making the Looking Glass Brook dance and ripple just as if it was giggling." Mr. Muskrat pulled his suspenders over his shoulders and winked slowly at both rag dolls. "Who knows?" he smiled. "Perhaps it is giggling at me, for you know, someone just played a prank on me." "But I believe I know who it was," Mr. Muskrat went on as he pushed his little round hat back and wiped his forehead with his red pocket hanky. "Who do you expect?" asked Raggedy Andy. "Well," laughed Mr. Muskrat, "when I came here to my kitchen door a few minutes ago, I found that someone had filled my doorway with pieces of mud and grass and completely closed it as tight could be. And in the soft dirt all around the doorway, I saw the tracks where whoever did it had walked. And I said, 'Ha ha, I know who made those footprints. It was Timothy Turtle.'" "How did you know that it was Timothy?" Raggedy Ann wished to know. "'Cause you see," said Mr. Muskrat, "Timothy Turtle wears four shoes, two on his front feet and two on his back feet, and he turns them in pigeon-toed when he walks. So you see, he left four pigeon-toed tracks. And now I'm digging my kitchen doorway open again, for it is time I had my dinner." "What will you do with Timothy Turtle when you catch him, Mr. Muskrat?" Raggedy Andy asked. Mr. Muskrat stuck his spade in the bank and sat down beside the two Raggedies. "Timothy Turtle is a funny fellow," Mr. Muskrat chuckled. "He plays a prank on someone, and then he walks away a few feet and pulls his head into his collar so that just his nose peeks out, and because he keeps his eyes closed."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.